You're very welcome as we gather for worship on this, the first Sunday in Lent in 2021. We come to raise our voices and our hearts in praise of our Lord God, the creator of heaven and earth and all that is found within them. So we turn to the Word of God as we read from Psalm 119, and we're going to read verses 25 through to 32. That's Psalm 119, 25 through to 32. I am laid low in the dust. Preserve my life according to your word. I give an account of my ways, and you answer me. Teach me your decrees. Cause me to understand the way of your precepts, that I may meditate on your wonderful deeds. My soul is weary with sorrow. Strengthen me according to your word. Keep me from deceitful ways. Be gracious to me and teach me your law. I have chosen the way of faithfulness. I have set my heart on your laws. I hold fast to your statutes, Lord. Do not let me be put to shame. I run the path of your commands, for you have broadened my understanding. And we say amen to the reading of the Lord's word. When we meditate upon the word of God, he does indeed broaden our understanding of the paths in which we walk to follow his commands. And if we do that, we will not be put to shame. And with the thought of walking in the Lord's paths, following his commands, meditating upon his word, let's turn to song as we sing together, Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heavens. And we also express that we know nothing, nothing is impossible for the Lord our God. And when we have sung, Ken will then lead us in our opening prayers.
Dear God, our Heavenly Father, as we meet today, apart but together, we thank you for the privilege of coming together in this way to worship you. We lift our hearts to you this morning, and we thank you for your promises to us. You are our rock where we find security. You are our Saviour, our Redeemer, and our friend. You lift our spirits as we struggle through the darkness of this pandemic. You have been with us throughout the past year. You are still with us, and you will remain with us to see us through to the end of the pandemic and beyond. We put our trust in you. Help us to sing your praises this morning, and help our minds to be still, peaceful, and quiet as we listen to your word. We sing and we pray and we pause. You are the Almighty, all-powerful and all-knowing. You can see into our hearts. Guide our thoughts. For those who are anxious, bring peace, bring comfort in our chaos. Let us join together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We thank Ken for leading us in our opening prayers, and I trust you were able to join in the singing of Ah, Lord God, in which we express that nothing is impossible for our God. As we make our way through life, there are times when things just seem to roll along with little or no change, to the extent that sometimes we might feel that we're stuck in a bit of a rut, doing the same thing day after day. A bit like the basis of the story in the film Groundhog Day, where things just keep happening the same thing day after day after day. But in that story, in that film, the main character, Phil Connors, has the opportunity to review his mistakes of the previous days. And then when the new day comes around, he's able to correct the mistake he made on the previous days so that he can sort his life out. Yet as we run through our normal everyday life, when things seem just to continue on very much as they are, we can't have the same exact day over and over again and correct our mistakes. But yet there are still things in our ordinary run-of-the-mill lives that, even although we sometimes feel we're stuck in a rut, will sometimes pull us up short and make us think. I'll assume here that most of you in your lifetime will have encountered one or two people whom you found it very difficult to get along with. Well, can I ask you to try to picture a setting where one of those people comes alongside you and gives you a warning? They warn you that someone else is out to get you. How do you react to that? Would you think, did they just give me a warning? Did they just tell me about a potential problem? Would you then think, oh, maybe they do care about me, even if it is just a little bit? Or perhaps would the more cynical side of your nature kick in and you would ask the question, why are they warning me? What's in it for them? A warning from an unexpected source is exactly what happened to Jesus in our scripture reading today. At this point in his ministry, Jesus is moving ever closer to Jerusalem. We can read in Luke 9:51. As the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. And Sarah will read for us now, and she'll be reading from Luke 13 and beginning at verse 31.
Luke chapter 13, verses 31 to 35. Jesus' sorrow for Jerusalem. At that time, some Pharisees came to Jesus and said to him, "Leave this place and go somewhere else. Herod wants to kill you." He replied, "Go tell that fox, I will drive out demons and heal people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will reach my goal. In any case, I must keep going today and tomorrow and the next day, for surely no prophet can die outside Jerusalem. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, You who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together, as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Thank you, Sarah, for reading that passage for us. And now we'll take the opportunity to raise our voices in song once more as we sing along with, Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus.
Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, vast unmeasured, boundless, free, rolling as a mighty ocean in its full.
In that passage from Luke 13, Jesus, accompanied by his disciples, is making his way towards Jerusalem. They're passing through towns and villages along the way, and Jesus is continuing to conduct his ministry. He's teaching those who have ears to hear and are willing to listen. He's healing the sick who are brought to him. He's driving out demons. It's just another ordinary day in the extraordinary life and ministry of Jesus. But on this occasion, we're told that some Pharisees appear on the scene. Now, we've got to remember that the leaders of the Pharisees were looking for ways to entrap Jesus, to discredit his ministry. They had said they wanted to kill him, to get rid of him. He had become a thorn in their flesh. Yet on this occasion, these Pharisees brought Jesus a warning. Leave this place and go somewhere else. Herod wants to kill you. Is it possible that these Pharisees had changed their attitude towards Jesus? Or is it a case that they had an ulterior motive in bringing that message that Herod wanted to kill him to Jesus? Yes, it is very probable that Herod did want to kill Jesus because he assumed that Jesus was John the Baptist, whom he had beheaded, raised from the dead. So he would want rid of Jesus. But perhaps the Pharisees brought Jesus this warning not to aid him in saving his life, but to further their end of getting rid of him. Because if Jesus heard the message that Herod was wanting to kill him, would he turn and run? And if he did, then that would have got rid of their problem with Jesus, at least in the short term. But if that had been their motivation in warning Jesus about Herod's threat, I wonder then how they reacted to Jesus' reply. Because he said to them, "Go and tell that fox, I will drive out demons and heal people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will reach my goal." From that reply, we can learn a few things about Jesus. Initially, we can learn that he was not going to be intimidated by King Herod. He would go where he wanted and when he pleased. He wanted to live his life in obedience to his heavenly Father and not in fear of Herod, of any man. Secondly, we know that Jesus did not regard Herod very highly, because to call him a fox was far from complimentary, because we tend to think of a fox as a sly, crafty animal that suits its own ends. Is that what Jesus was saying Herod was? Who was a self-seeking person, not to be feared at all? But the Pharisees, would they take the message back? Would they go back to Herod and tell him that Jesus said he would be there to achieve his goal on the third day? And what would Jesus' goal have been? We know he was making his way towards Jerusalem, but it may well have taken longer than 3 days from where he was to he eventually reached Jerusalem. But he knew he was heading to Jerusalem, and he knew of that city. And I believe that in speaking of Jerusalem as his goal, he was well aware of what was going to happen there. For surely no prophet can die outside of Jerusalem. To me, that indicates that Jesus was predicting his own death and where it would take place, in the city of Jerusalem. And while there was a degree of hardness in Jesus' attitude toward Herod and calling him a fox, there was also a much gentler side in Jesus' expression of compassion to the city of Jerusalem and its inhabitants. Think of what Jerusalem represented to the people of Israel. It was the symbolic heart of their nation. Jews from all over the known world travelled to worship in the temple where they held their God set enthroned. Jerusalem was the very heart of the religious life of this people. And yes, Jesus was aware that the people of this city were not perfect. "You who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you." He knew that the people of that city had rejected God's approaches to them through prophets and messengers down the years. And yes, he was going there with a message. He knew there were people who were difficult to reach. Yet think of the way he describes that city and its people. Think of the imagery that he uses in the metaphor here, that of a mother hen gathering her chicks under its wings. I don't know if you've ever seen a hen gathering her chicks under her wings and settling down on them. When she does, the chicks cannot be seen. They're safe under her body and under her wings. Oh, she is not applying pressure to the chicks. She's rather shielding them with her body. And it has been known for a mother hen to remain on her chicks, protecting them, even when her own life is threatened, she stays there. And Jesus was using that imagery to speak of his willingness to love and care for the city of Jerusalem and its people. Sadly, he was aware that they would not be willing to listen to him. But yet, the offer of his tender love and care was going to be poured out upon them. Would they hear it, or would they reject it? He ultimately knew that he would be rejected. I wonder, does Jesus look upon us today with the same compassion and love and longing to care for us that he had for the people of Jerusalem who were going to be unwilling to receive his love during his ministry? But are we so well settled in our lives and our rut that we're not hearing the warnings that's been spoken to us? We're not listening to what we're being called to. We're rejecting the message that is coming to us time and time again. Are we in a frame of mind like the character Phil Connors in Groundhog Day, that we can live through a new day, repeat the previous day, only correct the mistakes of our past? We can't go back and change what has happened, but we can change our future. We can listen to the one who has promised to come. Listen to what Jesus said. I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The people of Jerusalem witnessed Jesus' arrival into that city in triumph. And then a few days later, they rejected him. They called for his death. Today, we hear the message yet again of Jesus' love for us. Are we prepared to listen to that message? Are we prepared to prepare for his return? Because we know on one day he will return. So how will we be found on that day? Will we be saying, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord? Will we be waiting as faithful servants, prepared to accept our Lord and Master? Because if we don't do it now, if we don't accept his love, his compassion, his care, his offer of salvation today, it will be too late to try to receive it when he does return. Will you hear his voice today? Will you respond to his call? Will you respond to his offer of love, his offer of care, his offer of salvation? It's offered. Will you accept it? Amen. Bobby will lead us in our prayers of intercession, and then we will sing together our closing hymn, and it's Come, Lord Jesus.
Let us unite in prayer as we bring our heart's request before our Lord. Lord, thank you that we can come before your throne of grace with confidence, and only through your grace can we be here in our own strength. We lift up to you, Lord, all the suffering of the world. Suffering, Lord, through this COVID pandemic, through prejudice, through persecution and all manner of injustice brought through colour, discrimination or faith. We remember, Lord, those in our world who work so hard to help and comfort those who are confined, those who are lonely, those who are lost for direction, those in despair. O Lord, Thank you for the blessings that we have received, the kind acts and brotherly love expressed by so many in our communities, showing your love, love for each other in action and in words. We remember all our National Health Service personnel, our doctors, nurses, ambulance crews, cleaners, and all who deliver important equipment with all the logistics of completing their deliveries. Lord, guide and protect them all from harm. Bless, Lord, our church families in Ballymoney, Port Stewart, Coleraine and Portrush, and across our land. Bless our ministers and their families. Bless our local preachers and all who contribute to our daily reflections. For those involved in bringing to our homes our Sunday service, Lord, such a blessing in these times. For all who for one reason or another can't be with us, we lift each one up to you, Lord, and ask your blessing upon them. And Lord, we continue to pray for deliverance from this virus. Thank you, Lord, that through your guidance, this vaccine in such a short time has been made available to all. And our hope and prayer is for the day when we realize we need each other, that we need thee in all our lives, so that we can share this wonderful love, a love that was shown to us at the cross. Father, thank you for the indescribable gift of Jesus Christ, your Son. Lord, for our circuit family, those who are ill, those who are missing loved ones, for our sister May in hospital and for those who are watching over her, Lord, you know each one and you know each family. Comfort them, Lord, we pray. Amen. Take your people home.
come together to worship the Lord our God, to lift our hearts and voices in praise of his holy name. Let us now part by blessing one another as we say together the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.